Hi, my name is Arjan Times and I'll be presenting what's coming to Jakarta Security today. Funny note, part of this presentation was made when I was actually in the city of Jakarta on the beautiful island of Java. A little about me, I'm a 40-ish developer from the Amsterdam region, which is a really beautiful place too. They're quite different from Jakarta. On the picture, you see me at one of the canals, or grachten, as we call them here. So what did I do that's relevant to this presentation? I was previously a JSF and Security EG member, and I'm currently the project lead for the respective Jakarta projects, which are Jakarta Authentication, Authorization, and Security. I'm also the co-creator of the OmniFaces library for JSF, which was a 2015 Duke's Choice Award winner. And I somewhat recently wrote two books, one about JSF and one about CDI. So the agenda for today is as follows. We'll quickly be looking at some basic concepts, after which we'll take a look at the history of security in the Jakarta EE platform. We'll thereafter take a look at what Security 1.0 brought to the table. And finally, we'll take a look at what's coming in the next version of Jakarta Security. Okay, so let's start with the basic concepts. In the context of this presentation, we mainly distinguish between two forms of Java security, Java SE security and Jakarta EE security. Java SE security is about securing a client, which is about code level security, where the user is the owner and the code is external and potentially hostile. Jakarta EE security is about securing a server, which means it's about user level security, aka principle based security, where the code is trusted and users are external and potentially hostile. Furthermore, we have the concept of authentication, which means to provide the system with proof that you are who you say you are, and authorization, which is about determining which permissions a caller or a user has in the system, or in other words, what a caller is allowed to do. Okay, so after we went through some of the basic concepts, we now move on to the history of security in the Jakarta EE platform. Let's start with the very early history, which is around 1998, when we didn't even have a J2 EE yet. In this time, Servlet and EGB had quite different and actually rather poor security models. Servlet had practically no security or authentication provisions at all, other than a get remote user method, which simply returns a string sent by the client, which can of course not be trusted. And the idea was basically that servlet containers were fronted by another server that would take care of security in some way. EGB did start out with declarative security for beans. It was a rather new idea at the time. It was accomplished via the set allowed identities method on the access control entity type, which was then serialized and shipped along with an application. XML deployments didn't exist yet. These were truly the olden days. In 1999, just before the turn of the millennium, we saw the first release of J2 EE 1.2, which included Servlet 2.2 and EGB 1.1. The versions involved didn't really make it sound like an initial version, but it actually was. Servlet 2.2 did introduce a small but quite powerful security paradigm, and except for some additions, it's still largely what we use today. EGB and Servlet were somewhat aligned with each other, both featuring a similar two-level role system, and very similar methods for programmatically checking roles and obtaining the caller principle. Although for some reason, Servlet used the term user, while EGB used the term caller. Unfortunately, we did run into some early problems, like the simple and declarative parts of the J2 EE security model worked quite well, But the problem was that the back end of this model was largely geared towards integrating existing applications into an office/LAN environment, and not so much towards individual web applications that handle their own security and security-related tasks, such as registering users. Part of this was roles that needed to be mapped to environment roles called groups, identity stores, which are the databases with users and roles such as an LDAP server, and they needed to be configured outside the application and typically required quite a bit of mandatory non-standard configuration. Another problem was that the pattern syntax for the servlet constraints, which are the URL patterns saying which URLs require a certain role, were somewhat underspecified. And equally problematic was the fact that there were no extension mechanisms in place to add new authentication mechanisms. The built-in ones were basically just there without any interface or class defined for them. Okay, so most of the problems just mentioned were targeted to be fixed for the release of J2EE104 in 2003. And recognizing that security is a cross-cutting concern that applies equally to servlet, EGB, and potentially other containers, two separate specs were created. So the first one is JASPIC, which is about authentication and specifies an interface for the general authentication mechanism. But general here means independent of servlet, EGB, or what have you. Then several profiles were created in the JASPIC spec, and each of them define basically how that specific technology, such as a servlet container, should integrate with this general interface. The other one is JAC, which is about authorization and essentially models the constraints on URLs and methods, as we just discussed, as a collection of Java SE permissions. And those permissions are stored by JAC in a kind of repository, which it can then use to make authorization decisions. So unfortunately, these solutions weren't exactly perfect. They did represent a different step forward. JASPIC has sadly missed the J2EE104 deadline, but on top of that had missed the one for Java EE5 as well. Reasons for this might have been that the initial scope was just far too ambitious. Okay, so the first major problem with JASPIC was that there wasn't a simple way to just register an authentication mechanism in a portable way. Instead, you had to register an entire machinery surrounding that. But perhaps the biggest problem, though, was that JASPIC had a chauffeur lacking TCK, which meant that it took about like 7 years after its initial release to finally be implemented well enough by most vendors. Another small problem either was that the servlet container profile was only recommended for servlet containers and not made mandatory. For something that was originally slated to be in the servlet spec itself, this was quite a problem. As only full Java EE implementations offer JASPIC, and thereby severely limiting its use. Okay, so having looked at the history of security in Java EE, we're now going to look to the introduction of Jakarta Security 1.0. Jakarta Security 1.0 was introduced in 2014, back then as the Java EE Security API. When all the Java EE specs were renamed, this one was renamed to Jakarta Security. Jakarta Security has been the result of quite a lot of discussions. Also a selection of the plans we had back then for improving the usability of JASPIC, as well as work done for the Omni Security and Octopus Security frameworks. It had one overarching motto, really, and that was to enable security in applications without requiring any kind of vendor-specific configuration. Back then, this was actually quite a radical idea for Java EE. Okay, so let's take a quick look at the features of Jakarta Security 1.0. So one of the important things was not reinventing any wheels, keep the spec small and lean. So this meant building on CDI, JASPIC, expression language. The HTTP authentication mechanism API was quite important. It had to be easy to define and register. And the built-in mechanisms, such as Form and Basic, had to use the exact same interface as custom ones. So we also went for a identity store API, which had to be easy to define and register. A couple of built-in identity stores, a database LDAP, that used the exact same interface as the custom ones. An identity store handler that orchestrates multiple identity stores, where a default suffices for most cases, and it had to be replaceable or decoratable due to it being a CDI bin. Okay, so regarding the Jakarta security implementations, there's essentially two of them. One is Eclipse Theria, and the other one is IBM OpenLiberty, and they're both certified. There's one in development, which is TomEE Security by Roberto Cortez. Theria itself is used by Eclipse CloudFish and by Red Hat WildFly, and Theria is also usable by Tomcat. Okay, so let's now take a look at security, Jakarta security.next. Okay, so the main epic that we worked on in Security 1.0 was authentication. We wanted to look at authorization too, but we just didn't have the time or the resources to do so. So for Jakarta Security Next, we will look at authorization. And this specifically means that we'll be looking at the CDI compatible ad roles allowed and custom authorization rules. So we'll see an example of this in a while. We will consider the authentication tab epic as well. So this basically means adding additional built-in authentication mechanisms, JWT, OpenID, OR2 are being considered. And we'll be looking at multiple authentication mechanisms. And multiple here means, for instance, multiple ones for an application where you can choose between one, so say like Google or email to log in. Another option would be to have separate parts of the application, separate paths, having each their own authentication mechanism. And finally, we could have a single path, having multiple authentication mechanisms working together in some way. So some kind of fallback. If one fails, you move to the other. Okay, so in order to evolve Jakarta Security, we do need to evolve the supporting APIs. As mentioned before, Jakarta Security builds on several other APIs. In this case, it's Jakarta Authentication, which was previously called JASPIC, and Jakarta Authorization, which was previously called JAC. Both of these are considered to be low-level specs, low-level APIs. They're not exactly APIs, they're more like SPIs, targeted at server vendors. And they're not targeted at application developers, though application developers can use them. So the proposal is, there's actually two proposals. One of them is to involve them mostly as being an SPI for Jakarta Security, meaning that the standalone use case will not be forgotten, but the emphasis will be on seeing them both as the standard SPIs for Jakarta Security. SPIs are not a unique thing for Jakarta Security. Other specs have them too, like CDI has quite a couple of them, JSF has them. So in this case, these will be the standard ones for Jakarta Security. And quite aligned with that, the proposal is to potentially move authentication authorization to subspecs of security instead of them being completely independent specs, as they are at the moment. Okay, for Jakarta authentication, we have several enhancements in mind. One of them is the JAXRS container profile. This means that there will be a specific profile detailing how a JAXRS container has to integrate with Jakarta authentication. At the moment, most JAXRS containers depend on servlet, so they kind of piggyback on the servlet container profile. But here we would define a complete standalone JAXRS profile. The next thing to be considered is a servlet container profile light. So this was suggested on the JASPIC mailing list. It would basically mean that we're going to check the entire spec, see if there's anything that's not really needed for the servlet container. So some of the things like registers, listeners to that, they're maybe not needed, so we could remove them. One of the other things we want to look at is extra status codes. So these things are quite important in JASPIC as they signal the part or the phase a module is in the authentication dialog. So one of the things that's missing, for instance, is if a module has decided to do absolutely nothing, so it just skips authentication entirely. So we might want to add that. Another one is a input code to indicate that the module was called as a result from HTTP servlet request authenticate instead of at the start of request. There's a variety of spec clarifications that we need. The need is a big word, as most implementations at this moment already do the right thing, but it's still good to have this in the spec as a clarification. And something we really need is the update on the Java 1.4 syntax that JASPIC is still using. So we're not even using generics at the moment, which we should. So for Jakarta authorization, we need a few enhancements as well. So probably one of the most important ones is the application local authorization modules. As mentioned before, one of the disadvantages of JAC, which it was previously called, is that the JAC provider could only be registered for the entire application server. If you want to go to a simplified authorization rules, which we'll demonstrate next, we do need this feature in the SPI. Otherwise, you can't set up these rules per application, and they're like really application specific. The other important thing is the portable group to role mapper. So at the moment, JAC providers do need to have access to a group to role mapper, even if there's no group to role mapping used at all. It needs to know what the groups are, how to fetch them from the subject that's being passed in. So those modules are typically specific to a application server, or they are specifically mapped to a JASPIC authentication mechanism, so they have to know each other. Otherwise it can't work. And to facilitate really portable modules, we should need this. So quite related to that, not just a mapper, but an API to read groups in principle, the principal calling name from a subject. So at the moment, the subject is essentially a black box. It's a group a bag of principles, an SHEC module, SHEC provider. You don't know what principle corresponds to what function. So these two, the groups and the principle color name, are really specific, and we need a way to fetch them from the subject. Then we need a API to get the current so-called policy configuration, which is the JAC term for the repository of permissions that was mentioned before. So at the moment we can't really do this. A policy essentially needs some implementation specific way to fetch this, and this is a quite standard thing to do. We should introduce an API for that. Finally, we do need to update some terms, like I just mentioned, JAC provider, which is essentially an authorization module. We can't use the term JAC anymore, but the question is even if we could, whether we would want it here, since JAC provider hasn't been really clear term to start with. Authorization module might just be a more clear name anyway. Okay, so let's look at some examples next. One of them is the mentioned drop-in roles allowed replacement, which would then be usable for CDI bins. The current roles allowed is just a simple annotation. It has to be interpreted by whatever technology it's being used with. At the moment in the Java EE platform and subsequently in the Jakarta EE platform, only EGB interprets it. So it doesn't really do anything by itself. It certainly isn't interpreted by CDI bins. So by making it the CDI interceptor, this would happen automatically. So one of the proposals is to call it color in role, but that's of course not final. Might be something else eventually. When we do this, we might add a couple of enhancements to it. So the current one is essentially a OR semantics. So it's only one of the roles listed in the annotation that the caller needs to be in. Sometimes you might want all of them, so you could introduce a new attribute for that. In this case, calling a role all off. Foo bar means that the caller had to be in both foo and the bar roles. The other thing is that there's essentially a difference between declarative security being used on beam methods that are being called by other beams, or beam methods that are being called in response to something like an HTTP request. So in the case of beams calling other beams, you want an exception, which is what the current roles allowed does. When you call an EGB bean that's secured, you don't have the role, it throws an exception. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, if you call a servlet that's secured, you don't have the right role, it doesn't throw an exception, but it triggers the authentication process. So if you have, for instance, a form activated as the authentication mechanism, you will get a form dialog. If you have basic, you get a basic one, etc. So if we would move this to the annotation, you might add an attribute for that. So the default would be to throw an exception, like roles allowed does in ECB. But optionally, you can have it cause a authentication dialog to be started, just as servlet does. Okay, so the next example will be about the custom authorization rules that we briefly mentioned before. So first, let's explain a little bit what they are about. So at the moment, a default check provider or authorization module processes a request for a permission by looking at three separate collections of permissions. So the excluded, the unchecked, the parole ones. Excluded means that a permission is always denied. Unchecked means it's always granted. And parole means the permission is granted if the caller is in the correct role. And then finally, a jack provider does a delegation to another policy if there happens to be one. So what a custom authorization rule would do is allow you to insert code to make a decision after each of those points, and then before and after them. So they'll have to be CDI-based callbacks, at least that's the plan. And they absolutely have to be trivial to register, as basically with all things in the Jakarta Security API. Okay, so let's take a look at some code. So what we're seeing here is a dynamic check on demand instead of fetching all roles when authenticating. And this essentially means that normally when a Jakarta authentication mechanism is called, then all roles are fetched at the moment of authenticating. They're put into the subject, and the subject is used later on for authorization decisions. So in some cases, this might be unwanted. So for instance, when the amount of roles to fetch is too large, or maybe there's an external security service being used that doesn't even allow you to fetch all roles. So what we're doing here is registering a authorization rule, which would effectively be a CDI callback. And via call of attributes, we define the moment this will be called. So in this case here, we set caller authenticated to true. So this would mean that it would only be called for authenticated callers. And the phase is before with the check, the unchecked collection. So this would mean it would be called at the beginning of the authorization process, the very beginning. So what the code does, it just delegates the call to this external service. And if this external service grants the permission, then we return a granted, otherwise denied. So in effect, it replaces the entire default authorization process. And this will essentially do this check every time an authorization decision has to be made. So of course, this might come at the cost of some performance, as this call will be done every time a role has to be checked. But otherwise, this would do it dynamically. And without authorization rules, this would be quite hard, if not even impossible, to do in Jakarta EE. Okay, so let's take a look at a second example of authorization rules. So here we'll take a look at time-based permissions. And in this case, suppose we want to have a role that's only valid at certain hours. So for example, it could be valid within business hours, but not valid after. So in this rule here, we check after the unchecked collection is being checked. And this would mean that excluded and unchecked permissions would already be looked at. So if something is always denied, always granted, it's already done by the default process. But if it comes down to role checking, then our code kicks in. And here we just delegate the call to a timer surface, which checks the permission, sees if it's outside the valid hours. If it is, it returns denied. And if it isn't, it returns continue, which we haven't seen before. So continue means that the default algorithm, the default process, will continue to be executed. So this would mean that the role would be checked as it would normally be checked. Okay, so let's take a look at the next example, which is about the color type to represent the current color for the user. So the thing is that the identity in Jakarta EE is currently represented by a type called the subject. And the subject actually originates from Java SE security being mapped to Jakarta EE security. And this is something that you see in a lot of places, like the principal type is actually from Java SE security as well. The code domain is from Java SE security, and there's quite a lot of those things. So a subject is actually not that specific to use. So it's a bag of principles, which means that it's a collection of different principles that can be everything. Like a single principle can be a name, an idea, a telephone number, a social security number, a role, what have you. So there's a radical proposal, perhaps, for Jakarta Security Next, and that's to introduce a type that more exactly represents the Jakarta EE color. And the Jakarta EE color has a very specific number of attributes, which is essentially just the color principal name and the set of roles. So this new type could potentially look like the following. So we see an interface here called color, which has three methods: get color principal, get roles, and get all principles. So basically here the color principal is the same thing that's returned by things like HTTP server request, get user principal, or the security context, get color principal. Get roles is the collection of roles being mapped from principles in the original subject. It has to be said that get roles here would be the static roles, so dynamic roles is obtained by the previous authorization rule that we saw, where roles are essentially fetched on demand from a security service, would of course not be included here. So this might also be somewhat confusing. And get all principles is essentially the list of raw principles. So this is just everything that's in the subject without any indication of which principle corresponds to which thing. So this thing is just, of course, a proposal. It's not entirely sure if we're going to go with something like this. And there's more questions, like, are we going to use this only for authorization, as shown in the authorization rule? Or are we going to introduce this as a general type? So it could be used in the authentication mechanisms. It could be like a completely general type. It could be injectable, like at inject current color or something like that. So these are all things we still need to think about, but the general idea is to introduce some type of color. Okay, so let's take a look at one more example. So this is one in Jakarta Authorization, and it's about a mismatch between the subject being used and a thing like protection domain being required for an authorization check. And in this case here, you'll see that there's quite a lot of code to do a simple check for a permission. So what we see here is that the subject is first obtained by a somewhat unwieldy looking call. But the real problem here is that the get policy implies method actually takes a protection domain, not a subject. So a protection domain is another Java SE type. The only thing we really need is the collection of principles, but it's quite unwieldy to pass it on via a protection domain. There's a lot of boilerplate being used here. Basically, everything has to be null, but still has to be put there. So we certainly should be able to do a bit better here. So one solution we could take a look at is by introducing a number of convenience methods. So one of these methods could be the policy context current subject as domain, as shown here. And this method would do exactly as it says. So it would return the current subject. So we won't need the elaborate code as shown before. And the subject would be returned as the protection domain right away. So we don't need to construct one and fill it in with the principles obtained from the subject that we obtained before. So this would look quite a bit shorter and quite a bit easier to understand when reading it. In Jakarta Security, we could even go one step further because the security context already implies the current user. So we would just need a check permission method and then pass it a permission instance. So of course, this is just an example of checking a permission, as in Jakarta Security. We already have a special purpose method to check the access to web resources. So this would be just a context has access to web resource method. So wrapping up, what are we going to do? For security next, we will focus on the authorization concerns first, which means we'll look at the CDI compatible roles allowed. We'll be looking at custom authorization rules, Jakarta authentication, and Jakarta authorization will most likely be retargeted as a standard SPI for Jakarta Security. We'll be looking at additional authentication mechanisms. Presumably, this will be JWT and OAuth2, among others. We'll take a look at a type to represent the current caller. And we might add a JAX-RS container profile in Jakarta Authentication. We'll take a look at local authorization modules and a group-to-role mapper for Jakarta Authorization. And we'll look at convenience methods for various tasks, such as obtaining the current subject as a protection domain. Okay, so as with basically every Jakarta project, you can help too. The GitHub projects are listed here on the slide, and the contact is there as well. So contributions are highly welcome. And that's it for today. Thank you.